Introduction into Expected Progeny Differences from the American Simmental Association. By the end of this program, you should be able to understand the history of beef cattle evaluation, define EPD, explain how to use EPD when evaluating multiple cattle, and understand how to use a single EPD. Objective number one, understand the history of beef cattle evaluation in the United States. Before we get into the discussion of how EPDs work, we must first reflect on the history of beef cattle evaluation. From the beginning of recorded lineages and the start of the registered breed associations in the USA during the late 1800s, purebred cattle were generally selected and marketed based off their pedigree and phenotype. Some cattle were considered more royally bred than others due to their ancestry. Many became more prominent only based off of their ribbons and banners that they won at state or national shows. Trends came and went during this era. Initially, cattle were the size they are today, but in the early 1900s, cattle were selected for smaller stature. These belt buckle cattle, as they were called, were very trendy at the time. This type of selection reigned supreme until the industry started to change in the middle of the 20th century. In the 1940s, cattlemen and women started recording production and performance records and propagating cattle that could outgrow others in the herd. This was a sensible move because the commodity markets require commercial cattle to be sold by the pound, hence heavier cattle were worth more at market time. To make heavier cattle, selection for larger cattle took place at a rapid rate. While cattle did grow much better than the baby beef era of the early 1900s, there was some cost that came along with this type of selection pressure. Cattle that became heavier at maturity were also heavier at birth, leading to dystocia or calving difficulty. Other problems became prevalent as well. Cow maintenance and the costs associated with it increased, and timely breedback on the cow herd was often poor. In the early 1980s, expected progeny differences, or EPD, formulas were developed and adopted by many of the larger beef breed associations. These complex mathematical equations use multiple pieces of information, like the EPD average of their parents, their individual performance in their own contemporary group, and the performance data of their offspring to give these animals a breeding value for individual traits. These values are used to compare cattle not only across groups within the same herd, but more importantly, allows for cattle to be compared across herds in varying environments. EPDs and the economic dollar value indexes, which started to be published in the early 2000s, which we will discuss in a later unit, have led to incredible improvement of beef cattle in just the few decades that they have been available. Objective number two, define EPD. Visual appraisal of beef cattle is important to sire selection. Examples that producers often refer to when analyzing cattle visually are usually skeletal structure, fleshing ability, and muscling that you can see with the eye. The average stockman can see this easily. To many breeders, it is felt that these visual traits are outside the realm of EPDs. However, this is not the case. The fastest way to fix visually appealing traits is through EPDs, although standardization for most of these phenotypes has yet to be established in the U.S. beef industry. We are seeing the start of this process, though, with examples of the upcoming foot structure and udder design EPDs. Traits of economic importance, such as growth, carcass quality, reproductive, and maternal factors, cannot effectively be selected based on visual appraisal alone. When evaluating breeding animals, it can be difficult to determine what portion of the animal's performance was due to the environment in which it was raised, which is a non-genetic factor. Therefore, to aid producers in determining the portions of performance that are directly affected by genetics, expected progeny difference values were created. It took many years for the modern EPD to develop. It was the culmination of works from Dr. Wilhelm at Iowa State University, plus Drs. Henderson and Miller at Cornell University, who continued to lay the framework for the early models. At Cornell, Drs. Quass and Pollock developed a more useful technology that the ASA used for many years until 2018, when the single-step model, our IGS multi-breed genetic evaluation, powered by Bolt software, was released. At the present time, EPDs and the data behind the formulas are calculated and maintained by breed associations or cooperating universities. All major beef breeds publish their respective EPDs through a semi-annual or weekly genetic evaluation. This information for Sim Genetics can be found on the herdbook.org website. It is important to understand the simple equation, P equals G plus E, or phenotype equals genotype plus environment. A phenotype, although often assumed as the visual appraisal of an animal, is actually any trait that can be measured. Phenotype is influenced by two things, the genetics of an animal and the environment in which the animal is raised. Examples of phenotypes in beef cattle breeding include birth weights, weaning weights, docility score, scrotal circumference, ribeye area, marbling score, fat thickness, etc. When defining the genotype of an animal, it is best explained as the animal's genetic makeup or sequence of genes. This is a unique combination of genes inherited from an individual's parents. Genotype has nothing to do with the environment in which the animal was raised, nor the one it was born in. The last important ingredient to the phenotype equation is the environment in which the animal is raised. This has to do with the feed and water resources, stress, the weather, etc. Environment is basically everything that is not genetic that affects how the animal grows and or performs and expresses its genetic potential. Objective number 3, explain how to use EPDs when selecting. Present day expected progeny differences are developed by using four major factors. The first is the information associated with the pedigree of the individual. This has to do with their parents' and grandparents' genetic evaluations. The next way is looking at the individual's performance data. How did they measure up to their contemporaries? How did they compare to those of similar age and similar genetics in the same environment on the same cattle operation? Progeny performance still carries the most influence when improving the accuracy of EPDs. Older, highly proven sires often have several thousand progeny records submitted, which overwhelms ancestor data, the individual's own records, and the latest ingredient, genomic predictions. DNA testing the animal to see which genetic markers for particular genes they carry or do not carry help to make genomic predictions. We can see which genes they do or do not have to potentially pass on to their offspring. This, like the other three ingredients, develop the modern EPD. Expected progeny differences are the gold standard in the beef industry in which we can evaluate the genetic makeup for a variety of important traits. EPDs are expressed as expected phenotypic differences in future calves of a particular animal. This allows for comparison of genetic merit and is expressed in units such as pounds, inches, percentage, etc. As you can see from the graphic below, if bull A and bull B are randomly mated to the same set of cows, and then the phenotypes like birth weight, yearling weight, ultrasound ribeye area, etc. are collected on the resulting calves, we would expect the calves from the two sires to perform differently for various traits. These differences are input into a fairly complex formula along with other information about the ancestry of the animal. This information is used to calculate EPDs. EPDs are only useful to compare animals. An EPD by itself is essentially meaningless. They will not give you the absolute prediction on anything when used by themselves. Let's look at three examples of how to use EPDs. Here we can see the EPD for calving ease direct of bull A versus bull B. When bred to virgin heifers, you would expect the calves out of bull A
to have 11% more unassisted births when bred to first-time calving females compared to those of Bull B. As we look at weaning weight, you can see a 14-pound advantage with calves out of Bull A. Finally, you can see that there is a half square inch advantage in carcass ribeye area of the calves by Bull A compared to the calves by Bull B. With all of this in mind, we find Bull A to be the most desirable due to its higher calving ease direct, advantage in weaning weight, and larger ribeye area EPD. All things that beef breeders can be financially rewarded for selecting. The cost of production and the income from production together determine the profitability of a beef enterprise. For a commercial producer, those traits that directly influence either a cost of production or an income from production are considered economically relevant traits. For seed stock producers, the economically relevant traits are the traits that directly influence either the cost of production or an income from production for their commercial customers. Ultimately, these commercial producers are the largest customers of the seed stock industry, with hundreds of thousands of cow-calf producers relying on only a small fraction of that number of seed stock producers to supply genetically superior breeding animals adapted to the commercial production system. Those traits that are not directly related to a cost or an income of production are, at best, indicator traits, and at worst, misleading. The easiest way to distinguish between economically relevant traits and indicator traits is to ask a specific question about the trait of interest. If that trait changes one unit, either up or down, with no changes to other traits, will there be a direct effect on an income or expense? The relationship between birth weight and calving ease provide an example of the distinction between an economically relevant trait and an indicator trait. Does a 1 pound change in birth weight directly influence an income or expense? Likely not, as that change may or may not result in increased or decreased calving difficulty. With calving ease direct, or CED, a 1% decrease, meaning one extra animal assisted for every 100 calvings, has a direct impact on profitability. Decreased calving ease results in higher labor costs, decreased calf survival, therefore fewer animals to sell, and delayed rebreeding for the cow, resulting in younger and hence lighter calves at weaning the following year. All of these have a direct impact on profitability. Birth weight is an indicator of the economically relevant trait, calving ease. Knowing the difference, which EPD should we look at for calving traits, calving ease or birth weight? The logical choice after reviewing the information is obviously calving ease.
Let's do one last example as if we were comparing bulls at herdbook.org. Remember, EPD stands for expected progeny differences. The weaning weight EPD is expressed in pounds. Now it's time to compare bulls A and bull B. Let's look at this example of how to use weaning weight EPD. You can tell that bull A has a weaning weight advantage when finding the difference of the two bulls. We will round these numbers, and as you can see, the difference between 82 and 70 is 12 pounds. This means that we would expect that Bull A will sire calves that are 12 pounds heavier on average when compared to Bull B when these calves are measured at weaning time. Objective number 4, understand how to use a single EPD.
It is sometimes hard for breeders to analyze EPDs because they analyze them only one animal at a time. Take a look at the EPD profile on this slide. If a breeder were to only analyze this single animal's weaning weight EPD, they would likely get pretty confused pretty fast. What does the weaning weight value of 71 mean to us? We know that the calves will not wean off at 71 pounds, logically. It sure doesn't mean that the progeny will weigh 71 pounds above breed average, so how can we analyze it? Remember, the proper way to use an EPD is to compare the difference of two or more animals. The American Simmental Association publishes percent ranks of our sires in the bottom row of the EPD table for each animal. This allows you to know how the sires may rank for particular traits amongst their given breed composition, whether they're purebred Simmental, hybrid, Simbra, etc. Another option is to refer to the percentile ranking table found at herdbook.org.
Knowing that the animal represented on the last slide was 71 pounds for weaning weight EPD, we can see by using the percentile ranking table, which can be found at herdbook.org, that the weaning weight EPD of 71 ranks near the top 15% of the purebred Simmental population. One can access these percentile ranking tables on the upper right-hand tab labeled Data Search of herdbook.org. Next, hover over the percentile and EPD averages, then click on the animal type. The desired percentile ranking table will now appear.
In summary, it is important to know that the history of beef cattle evaluation has been very complex over the last 100 years and has since taken an objective and scientific approach over the last several decades. EPDs are calculated by very complex mathematical formulas that use several pieces of information to predict the genetic differences in two or more animals. And finally, it is important to understand EPDs as they are easy for the producer to use when comparing two or more animals' genetic merit.
Resources for this presentation came from the National Beef Cattle Evaluation Consortium Sire Selection Manual, 2nd edition, the Beef Improvement Federation, and the American Simmental Association leadership.